In the first video, we took you from one school to all the schools of the world, and now what we're going to do is move from one school inwards and take a look at what goes on in terms of classrooms, desks, chairs, writing equipment, and how that's developed and changed over the last 200 years. So really, this time around, we're going to go from a medium-sized object, the school, and we're just going to go into finer and finer detail to find out about its innards. And what you can see in front of you is the picture of a beautiful classroom. It's the Crow Island School. It's considered to be one of the most successful architectural examples of a class. And I think across the world nowadays, we tend to assume that the classroom is a pretty natural object. It's something which is obvious. You have a teacher, you have around 20 to 30 to 40 students, if you're lucky, sometimes more, sometimes less. But pretty much the classroom seems to be the organizing unit of a school. Now, it certainly wasn't always like that. And let's go back 200 years and let's go back to England, where you have a pressing issue to do with the poor kids roaming around the streets and the need to keep them under control, and the way to control them was to educate them. There was also a demand for an increasing docile labour force, given the demands of the Industrial Revolution, and this was one of the ways to discipline children. Now, firstly, notice that you don't have a classroom, you have a schoolroom. And what happened was, all the different kids from all the different grades were actually put in rows rather than in classes. And what you had along the side was you had monitors who continuously checked that the kids were doing the work. Now, let's take a kind of architectural view of this to see if we can make sense of how it works. Well, what you can see is in the front, that's where the teacher come lecturer come principal of the school stands, and then what you have is you have all these rows with learners sitting in the various rows from grade 1 through to grade 8. And what would happen is the kids would do their work on slates, which I'll show you later. Monitors at the side would check that the work was done, and then they would help the kids to understand certain parts of the lesson which were difficult to understand or needing teaching around the little semicircles you can see at the top of the diagram. Let's put some pictures to it so we can actually get a sense of it and get a sense of how they try to work this massive system. The first point you need to kind of understand is that this had to be run almost on military principles. Because you had so many kids in a room at the same time, you had to be very disciplined and ordered about it. So, for example, if you had an end of a lesson, what would happen is there'd be a very specific way of actually shutting the thing down. You'd start off by saying return, and then what would happen is the student would grab the slate which he'd worked on, and he'd get it ready, and then the slate would be lifted and placed in the groove, and then you'd have a situation where there'd be lift and the flap would be lifted and desks, and then what happens is the hands are dropped so you can stand up at the instruction of stand, and at the word out, out you get from the sides of the desks. Now, that's a really interesting situation you can see happening, where we have all sorts of great academic writers and intellectuals like Foucault talking about the disciplinary systems that operated and how power systems operated. But it really doesn't take a genius to see that there's some military principles in operation over here. Now, the second point which I want to make in terms of this model, and it was called the Lancastrian model. It was very popular in England, and then it spread across the world into the United States and to some extent in Europe, although not as much. And the second thing you'll note is that you don't necessarily have to have teachers teaching the kids. Why not just have an older kid? And there you have a situation where what happens is the children who are in one kind of grade, well, what happens is they're instructed to write something on a slate. They then all hold it up. The monitor checks whether it's correct or not, corrects the kids who are wrong, they rub it out, and so they go on. And that was the system, and it worked all the way through the grades. To actually explain something to the kids, what would happen is the kids of that specific little grade would gather around the monitor at the side and he'd instruct them, and then they would go back to their desks, entering them in a highly ordered way to do the work. And it really fascinates me because you kind of assume in our modern day world that the classroom is pretty much the organizing device of the school, but it wasn't always like that, and it wasn't obvious. Increasingly, and really, I suppose, the classroom model really took off in Germany, in Prussia, where they kind of worked out all the technicalities of how a proper classroom should be constructed and built. And this model, and let's face it, the German model was the most successful and powerful model of education in the 19th century, started to take off across the world, even though it was far more expensive than the monitorial model, because number one, you needed classrooms, and number two, you needed teachers. But the net effect with classrooms and teachers was that you had a better education system operating. Now, once you start to go inside the classroom and start to try and work out what the furniture of the classroom is like, well, this is a picture of an early 20th century attempt to work on classroom furniture. It was a first generation of solutions. And what you can see is how idealistic and complicated it was. There was an attempt to make sure that the chair and the desk would adjust in any and every single way to make the learning easier and more comfortable for the kids. Now, the problem is with mass schooling. When you're dealing with millions, not hundreds or thousands of desks and chairs, this just becomes impossible because you need simpler solutions. And what you found very quickly happening in Europe with the second set of solutions, when they realized that this kind of massively complex adjusting system was impossible, was to create as simple as a design as possible, which could be replicated in factories and done quickly and easily, both for single chairs and desks, and for double chairs and desks. Attached, simple, elegant, and durable. Now, as we move through the 20th century, we get to our kind of modern 21st century situation. And what I'd like to do is I'd like to show how we currently see the ideal model of school furniture operating. The first thing I'd like to emphasize is the fact that you should have around a 135 degree angle between your torso and your legs. This creates a situation where you don't slouch. It's so much better for your spine. I can actually feel myself straightening up as I'm talking right at the moment because I slouched at the desk. You have a situation where you can breathe properly. Your body is more open. You don't crouch over the desk, causing back pain, which is a major problem throughout the schooling world because of the crappy furniture we have for our kids. Notice the angle of the desk. Notice that there's a book ledge behind, all of which is adjustable, and in a situation where you can stretch your feet out and you can look both at your creative work, which is quite close to you, and your reading work, which is slightly further away from you. A wonderful example, but this is too complicated and too expensive for our current macroeconomic order of schooling. And what we rather need is we need our beautiful plastic chairs, which can be pumped out at the rate of one every 70 seconds. It's polypropylene. What happens with it is that you just use a mold and pump them out one by one by one. They are durable. They fill up our beautiful rubbish sites, because once they break, they're not able to be fixed. But they certainly are very cheap. And secondly, you have the wonderful trapezoid desk, which can be put into any shape in terms of group learning. If you want a semicircle, or if you want kids working on the side, or if you want to adjust the classroom, it's a very adjustable form of furniture. And there we have our modern equivalent of school furniture. Now, moving from the classroom down to desks and chairs, and finally into the stuff that we wrote about, you saw that in the 19th century, one of the dominant technologies of writing was the slate. And it's got many virtues. It's durable. When you write with it, you can erase the stuff and then use it again and again and again, year after year after year. But things have evolved since then, and now we don't have this kind of a slate. We have this kind of a slate. It can do far more things. It's the internet's available. All the lessons are downloadable. You can have interactive lessons on it. It is absolutely astonishing. But boy, it can break. It needs maintenance. It's in a situation where it outdates itself very quickly. But certainly the shift from that old slate to the new slate has meant a massive shift in the way teaching and learning is happening currently in our classrooms. And of course, it's gone even further than that. We now have virtual classrooms where you can have a situation where you have the different students all together on your computer page, all able to talk to each other. And then the teacher teaching the lesson does it on a virtual whiteboard, which everyone can see. And often people can actually participate on and ask questions and get answers at the same time. It doesn't take a school. It doesn't take a classroom. It doesn't take furniture. All it takes is setting up the right computer with the right equipment and getting people who actually know how this works. And that's always been a problem throughout the history of education. When they introduced the blackboard around 180, 200 years ago, you should have heard the teacher shouting and screaming about how difficult it was and how impossible it was to use a blackboard. I mean, what was that? Why would you use it? How does it work? What's this thing called chalk? How do you write on it? And we can see similar things happening now with our whiteboards and our situations where we're dealing with more and more technology, which has got to the point now where you are sitting watching me deliver a lesson on how schooling works using the computer, and hopefully it's working.